District 2 Community Board of Education meeting. Mr. Manning.
Here.
Mrs. Gleason.
Here.
Mr. Johnson. Mrs. Jones. Mrs. Camworth here. Mrs. Ressler.
Here.
Ms. Stern.
Here.
Ms. Rice.
United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
This time we're looking for a motion to approve the ease ordinance of February 16th, 2012.
So moved. Second.
First, Mrs. King, second by Mr. Johnson. Any discussion? Mr. Manning.
Aye.
Mrs. Gleason.
Stay.
Mr. Johnson.
Aye.
Mrs. Camworth.
Aye.
Mrs. Ressler.
Aye.
Ms. Stern.
Aye.
For recognition award.
Mark. Christine.
Good evening. Ms. Matthews, could I have you come up, please?
Oh, sure.
Patrice Matthews is the principal attorney of the Hall Legal Agency. Patrice is a former Illinois state prosecutor. She was raised in Homewood, Illinois, and attended Homewood Flossmoor Community High School. Patrice is a graduate of Washington University in St. Louis and attended Chicago Kent College of Law, where she earned her law degree. After graduating from law school, Ms. Hall worked as an assistant attorney general with the Office of the Illinois Attorney General under Lisa Madigan. After gaining experience, Patrice decided it was time to realize her dream of opening and operating her own practice. She wanted to serve people in their most dire times of need. Patrice is a participant of the Chicago Bar Foundation's Justice Entrepreneurs Project and has a concerted focus on serving as a neighborhood lawyer. She became involved in the Cook County Court 6th Municipal District High School Mock Trial Competition 2 years ago, volunteering to coach the Hillcrest High School team. This is Patrice's second year with the Hillcrest team. Last year, she coached them to a fourth-place finish. She then hired one of the team members, senior Tondalea Davis, to work in her office. Patrice started coaching the team again in November of 2015. She dedicated countless hours of professional time several times a week to prepare the students for the 2016 competition. Her dedication and investment paid off with a first-place finish for Hillcrest. She was a critical factor in assisting the team's advance to the state competition that will be held April 2nd and 3rd at the University of Illinois Law School in Urbana, Illinois. I introduce to you our volunteer of the month, Patrice Matthews.
This Volunteer Excellence Award is presented to Patrice Matthews. You have helped to provide a positive learning environment for the students of District 228 by the time and talents you share. Thank you for caring.
Congratulations. Autumn Clemens and Moriam Yarrow.
This affair was a celebration of African and African-American culture. The fair promoted pride through a celebration of music, dance, food, art, literature, clothing, and much more. Approximately 200 students, staff, and community members attended this well-organized event. The Hillcrest Career Day 2016, titled Exploring the Path to Success, occurred on February 24th, and during the career fair, students were able to speak with professionals from over 30 organizations to receive firsthand information from employers regarding their professions and job opportunities. Hillcrest's goal is for each student to be college and career ready. The Black History Month celebration occurred on February 25th and was led by Mr. Keith Anderson, Fine Arts Supervisor. The program was highlighted by the guest speaker, Quavina Antoine Nixon. Quavina Antoine Nixon is a spoken word artist that provided the students with many encouraging messages. The event also featured performances by the band, choir, Flight Poets, Drama, the Symphonic Band, and student Edward Little. On that same evening, our family reading night was held in the IMC. For this promotion of literacy, the Grand Prairie Public Library staff members assisted with the entertaining and engaging readers' theater. Members of the Hillcrest mock trial team, flight poetry, and speech also engaged the students. The event was enjoyable and everyone was actively involved in the combination of performance and oral reading. The Hillcrest mock trial team won the Cook County Court 6th Municipal District mock trial competition that was held on February 20th at South Suburban College. The team defeated Mother Macaulay High School in the final round to win the championship. The team is sponsored by Mrs. Carolyn Snyder, and assistance has been provided by our volunteer attorney, Mrs. Catrice Matthews. The numerous hours of work definitely paid off for this team. The mock trial team will next compete at the state meet held at the University of Illinois, Champaign-Urbana, on April 3rd. On February 26th, Mr. Mooney's Ecology Club, along with Mr. Switzer and Mrs. Tate's chemistry student, loaded a bus headed to the slopes in Andalusia, Illinois. Both Bremen and Hillcrest chemistry students collaborated and took the ski slopes for a lesson on weather and the atmosphere. Students received skiing instructions for approximately 45 minutes and afterwards were allowed to explore the slopes and inquire about climate. During the bus trip, students calculated pressure, temperature, and composition of air at various altitudes. They also discussed the effects of global warming and reviewed weather maps. This was both an amazing academic and athletic experience. The staff at Ski Snow Star was amazed and impressed by the students' attitudes to learn and their determination on the slopes. As always, Hillcrest is the home of the Hawks. We are a school community with high expectations, high standards. We accept no excuses, and there are no exceptions.
Good evening. Representing Oak Forest High School today is an individual you will see in May. I won't take away, but she'll be up on stage for graduation. So Kika Arias, come on up, and she's going to share a little bit about her experience at Oak Forest.
My name is Kika Arias, and thank you for having me. I would like to highlight our competitive academic activities. I have been a member of the speech team for 3 years. We compete in various tournaments leading to the IHSA regional, sectional, and state tournaments. It has been 4 years since we've qualified and won at state. This season, my partner Don Littleton and I competed in dramatic duet acting and placed at regionals advancing to sectionals. Individually, I placed first in radio speaking at the regional competition and second at our sectional competition, thus qualifying for state. I am also involved in both Scholastic Bowl and Math Leagues and have competed in both programs for 4 years. This year, Scholastic Bowl won second place at SSE competition. We had several individual winners and math in both programs, and Math Leagues had one freshman, sophomore, and three varsity conference championship teams. I was honored to be a part of all three varsity championship teams and was one of the competitors to submit perfect papers. In addition, I competed in the SSC science competition that took place last week. I was a medalist in several events along with my teammates who won individual championship titles and received gold, silver, and bronze medals. In fine arts, we had outstanding performances at the IHSA solo and ensemble competition. Our program received 13 band and choir Division I soloist awards. We also had several Division I band and choir ensembles. I was excited to be one of the musicians who was awarded a Division I ranking in the instrumental ensembles. My ensemble was half a point away from a perfect score. Marley Majetic, another one of our instrumentalists, earned a perfect score and soloist of the day for the third consecutive year. Being on all of these competitive teams has shown me the importance of balancing academics with activities. I bring great leadership skills and gain the ability to motivate myself and my teammates to improve continuously. All of this involvement has helped me to realize my own capabilities. And as a result of all these experiences, I feel more confident in my talents as I move on to college, where I will be studying with some of the best and brightest students in our nation. On behalf of Oak Forest High School, I would like to thank the Board of Education for giving me the opportunity to highlight our activity program. Thank you.
Keegan was going to read the Tinley Park good news, so thank you for her. Thanks for that. I just wanted to let you know, though, that the administrative team is kind of doing triple duty tonight. Randy Kaunhoven and Wendy Bumpus are at the Rotary Top 10 at Lincoln Way. Teresa Nolan and Mike Mongan are at the Village of Tinley Park. They're honoring the West Wrestling Program, and I got first choice, and I'm important. So.
The good news report from Tinley Park. One is that five Business Professionals of America students have qualified for the national competition in Boston in May. These students are Dora Alexilmas, Pamela Osterman, and Tia Webster, who placed first in video production events. Amber Hollick, who placed second in two events, entrepreneurship and advanced interviewing skills. And Ashley Santos, who did place first as well in fundamental word processing. Another congratulations goes to both the Tinley Park Concert Band and the Symphonic Band. The Symphonic Band placed Division I rating and placed third place in a competition of 15 bands. The Concert Band received a second division rating in their class as well. Another is TP Science Club, which was victorious in the SSC competition last week at Oak Lawn. Anthony Owens came in third with a mousetrap vehicle. And Casey Weisbus took home gold with his first place winning in the What Are You Trying to Tell Me competition. Another congratulations goes to Eric Schultz. Walking the halls of Tinley Park High School is a state champion. On Sunday, February 21st, Eric Schultz became a second, a 2A 190-pound IHSA wrestling state champion. Led by the head coach, Mr. John Pfeffer, and an assistant coach, Mr. Ross Cardellino. This season has been one of the most off-the-record books of Titan wrestlers. The Titan team did exceptionally well at the state series, ended with Caesar Clark placing sixth for the 140-pound weight class, and Eric Schultz taking first in the 190-pound weight class. Eric ends his high school career by following in his father's footsteps, Eric Schultz, senior as the wrestling state champion for the Tinley Park High School in 1987, and the last person to win the state for the Titans in this sport. That is all for tonight, and I'm proud to call myself a Titan. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. I'm very happy to have a senior, Sterling Johnson, here tonight with us to give the Bremen Good News Report.
Yes, Sterling. I'm a senior at Bremen High School, just looking to go abroad for college to study accounting in your future.
At Bremen, we have 169 students who made the honor roll during the quarter. Now the professors would like to encourage all students to continue to focus their studies and finish the year by meeting the individual academic goals.
On Thursday, March 10th, the Key Club at Bremen High School has conducted a blood drive, and there was successful over 140 pints of blood to the local blood bank. The students and staff at Bremen High School is very proud to announce the contribution to the community as it makes a difference. On our annual four blood drive is scheduled for March 18th and Saturday, March 19th at Bremen
that Rivers can join the Bill 4K Midlothian Wolstead Drive and ride with armed with Bremen. $20 per position, and we are looking to raise a maximum of $6,000 scholarship and take gazebo funds. Come out and support this event by taking a test drive or writing and completing a short survey. For athletics, we have all conference students. Girls basketball, we have Royale Williams. Cheerleading, we have Abby Wake, Justice Gallano Davis, and Olivia Budd. Palm, Sydney Ferreira, and Mackenzie Cowley. Girls ball, we have Paige Shaw and Stacey Sheldon. And boys basketball, we have Weston Gray. And for boys ball, we have Jacob Ciccone. Phil Powers, who have won a $5,000 scholarship to tuition scholarship for Bears Care and National Foundation for Chicago Metro Chapter. He's one of two students in the state to receive this prestigious award.
$14,000 yearly scholarship to Millikan College. So, now I'd like to introduce our presentation tonight, Ms. Snyder, Ms. Matthews, and some of the members of our state-bound mock trial team. You see, we have a theme here tonight at Hill Crest. Many of our mock trial members are currently working as election judges, so they're not able to be here tonight. But I think you'll enjoy what you're going to see.
All right.
I'd like to introduce several of our members from the team. This is Tom Delay Davis. Tom Delay will be giving our closing argument today. Darlena York will be giving this is the defense side, by the way. The plaintiffs are all serving as election judges today. We have 85 students here at Hillcrest serving the community, several communities today as election judges. I have three of the ten team members here. So Tom Delay will be doing the defense closing. Darlene will be doing the opening for the defense, and we have one of our expert witnesses, Alexis Woods, who will be playing a doctor, Taylor Worsley, and Tom Delay will be doing a cross-examination of Taylor Worsley. Our case is a state case that all high schools will be arguing throughout the state, and we do it in regions. So 6th Municipal District, the 5th Municipal District, all throughout Coop County, all throughout Will County, all throughout the state of Illinois. It was a hockey case where we had a plaintiff and defendant. The defendant hit that plaintiff. The plaintiff suffered a concussion and there was over $100,000 worth of damages. These fine ladies had to defend the young man or young lady that hit the other hockey player and try and get him off. So we're going to hear their side of the case. And we're going to start with.
Why don't you guys turn around so you
can okay. So Darlene will start with the opening. I'm going to ask the other two to sit down and while we do this.
Yeah, wait for us to come up. Yeah. So we won't have our backs to anybody. Okay. Yeah.
Wonderful.
Altercations. and it's not uncommon for a player to get hurt. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this game was not unlike any other. Pat was hurt and Chris was hurt. You'll hear from Chris Davies herself, and she'll tell you that midway through the game, while she was chasing the puck towards the goal, Pat Dunn intentionally tripped her with his hockey stick, causing her to fall on the ice. Afterwards, a fight broke out. And during this altercation, Pat Dunn punched Chris Davies in her face, nearly breaking her jaw. And in response, Chris regrettably retaliated. Now, Chris isn't proud of her reaction, and as a result, she's faced numerous consequences. She's lost her job, her only source of income. She's had to pay a substantial fine, and her reputation is tarnished. Additionally, you'll hear from our expert witness, Dr. Cameron Leonard, who examined Pat Dunn on February 17th. And she'll tell you that the only injury Pat Dunn sustained is a cut, and he has no permanent injuries. The evidence will show you tonight that the only person negligent is Pat Dunn, because despite being a hockey player with ample experience, he chose not to wear a helmet during this game. The evidence will also show you that Pat Dunn was aware of the importance of wearing proper headgear, because he had suffered a previous head injury before. Now, as the jury, you are charged with the responsibility of applying the facts to the law. And at the end of this trial, my co-counselor, Tongalea Davis, will come before you in closing argument and ask you to return the only verdict that is just and true, which is to find my client, Chris Davies, not liable on all counts. Thank you.
Shown up, Eniola Awani. She was our plaintiff's attorney, and she is going to be directing our expert witness, Taylor Worsley, also known as Alexis Woods. Right here, okay? Huh? You ready to go? Okay, good. No more.
No more.
State your name, spell your last name for the benefit of the court.
Dr. Taylor Worsley, W-O-R-S-L-Y.
Thank you. Are you a practicing doctor?
Yes, I am.
And can you detail me your educational background?
I graduated from medical school in 1981. I did residency from 1981 to 1984, and I began my practice in 1985.
And where do you practice?
At the Worsley Medical Center.
How long have you been practicing medicine?
I've been practicing medicine for 35 years.
And what areas of medicine do you practice within?
I'm board certified in the areas of psychiatry and neurology.
Do you know Pat Dunn, the plaintiff in this case?
Yes, I do.
And how do you know him?
I examined him.
And to a reasonable degree of medical certainty, would you say that you reached a medical conclusion?
Yes.
Your Honor, at this time, I'd like to tender Dr. Worsley as an expert witness in the fields of neurology and psychiatry. Your medical conclusion, what was it?
My medical conclusion was that Pat Dunn suffered from an acute subdural hematoma caused from the blow to the head on February 17th, 2015.
And how did you reach this medical conclusion?
I conducted a series of tests on Pat Dunn.
Can you describe these tests that you performed?
I performed a symptom assessment, clinical cognitive testing, clinical balance testing, and clinical cognitive.
And what were the results of these tests?
That Dunn had suffered from an acute subdural hematoma.
And what symptoms did he display?
He displayed difficulty with visual memory, calm memory, inattentiveness, and slow information processing.
Dr. Worsley, what was the full scope of your medical findings?
Well, there's two other things worth mentioning. There's indication of a chronic subdural hematoma and frontal lobe damage.
Frontal lobe damage. How did you come to this conclusion? What symptoms led you to this conclusion?
The inattentiveness and the slow recovery.
And the chronic subdural hematoma. Why is that important?
It's indication of a chronic subdural hematoma because the CT scan was taken 2 weeks after the initial incident.
So if the CT scan was taken, say, February 17th, 2015, the actual date of the incident, would it show differently?
absolutely, because anything of this, anything, it's time sensitive and it ages over time.
How does an acute superior hematoma look on a CT scan as opposed to a chronic superior hematoma?
It looks lighter on the CT scan, and as whereas in a chronic superior hematoma looks darker on a CT.
Dr. Worsley, can Pat Dunn ever be healed from this type of horrible head injury?
I cannot overemphasize how terrible and traumatic a head injury is to a patient, but I have opted to giving him bi-weekly checkups and medication to reduce the swelling on his brain.
Thank you, Dr. Worsley. No further questions.
Part of the game. And on February 17, 2015, that's exactly what occurred. A normal hockey game. Now, the plaintiffs would like you to believe that my client caused their client substantial damage and the cause of causation, duty, breach, causation. Now, duty. My client does not have a duty to look out for anyone but himself on the court. Causation. My client did not cause any damage, substantially damage that would have caused the lifetime to their client. Now, there's one count of battery in this case and one count of negligence. Battery is the intentional harm of another person. Negligence is failure to complete or look out for the safety of others. The only person who was negligent in this case was Pat Dunn. He had a previous head injury 12 years ago where he sustained a concussion. And despite that, he chose not to wear a helmet on February 17th, where he then hit his head again. That's negligence. Battery. My client did not intentionally try to harm Pat Dunn. After a tussle, and after Pat Dunn punched him in his face, she retaliated in self-defense by raising her stick and hitting him. Now, she has lost her only source of income. She's lost her passion. She's lost her reputation. Don't further damage her. You have one job when you go into this jury room. That is to apply the facts to the law and use your common sense. Now, I explained to you the law. One count battery, one count negligence. The fact is, my client did not want to intentionally cause harm to Pat Dunn. The fact is, Pat Dunn did choose to not wear a helmet that day. You have one job, to come back with the only verdict that is just and true. To find my client, Chris Davies, not liable on all charges. Thank you.
Thank you, that's our presentation. The whole thing, I gave a second.
Well, I want to be a lawyer and then I'll got involved with us?
Yeah, my first time involved in the monster. Tell the truth. Honestly, when I first came to school, I was shit out of that. All of that was shit out of that. I got into monster. I was trying it. And it was something that changed. I just speech too. And it said, I'm trying to watch a debate. But it ended up being so much more. And there I met my boss, Patrice Hall. Honey Matthew. And I fell in love with
mom,
and that's who I
wanted
to
serve. Very good. Very proud of you guys.
We need
more women out here. Good job.
Yeah, that's great. Good job,
ladies. Good
luck.
Thank you.
Where's that going to be at?
University of Illinois.
Law school, yep. You will find law school.
April 2nd and 3rd.
Freedom of Information Act. We have requests since our last board meeting. Tim Lazar from the Illinois Policy Institute requested the city of residence for active IMRF and TRS employees by total counts. This request has been filled. Ms. Gabriella Marcarella, data acquisition specialist from Smart Procure, requested all purchase orders from October 20th, 2015 to date, including purchase order number, date, line item details, quantity, price, vendor ID, and contact information. This request is being processed. Excuse me. Later in tonight's meeting, the board will be authorizing the staffing for the 2016-17 school year. The sectioning process resulted in an additional 8 class sections and additional 1.9 teachers. This recommendation comes after hours of extensive and creative planning by our administrative team. I'm confident that this recommendation is fiscally responsible and happy to report that all current full-time JFA members will maintain their teaching positions for the upcoming school year. Our District 228 Spirit Showdown fundraiser was held at Oak Forest High School on March 10th. Just a few of the ways our students and staff compete at this event for an overall spirit winner includes dodgeball, drumline, school colors, tug-of-war, and men's dance. The cost of entry is the donation of a canned good, which goes to Together We Cope, our local food pantry. Tinley Park High School was the overall winner in this year's event, and I'm happy to report that more than 2,500 pounds of food was donated to Together We Cope. The 42nd Annual District Fine Arts Festival will take place this Thursday evening at Bremen High School. This event highlights our students from all four schools and includes an art gallery from 5 to 8 and a concert starting at 6:30. All are welcome. Thank you.
Do any board members have anything they'd like to say?
Oh, yes, I do. I just want to make a statement on the surveys that went out. In light of the recent resignations, which prompted some teachers to speak at a board meeting, and others who have reached out to board members, stating that we are letting good talent get away from our district, and that something needed to be done. It was decided in a personnel committee meeting on February 9th to prepare a survey giving the staff the opportunity to express their concerns openly and honestly, with the option to state their name or not, and have the surveys returned to the board and not to the top administration. Upon review of these surveys, we clearly have issues with lack of trust, lack of communication, and low morale among our staff. Unfortunately, these negative feelings ultimately have an impact on our students. At the end of almost all of these surveys, the staff expressed their gratitude for the opportunity to express their concerns, and most of all, hope that action would be taken to improve the district, and that this was not just a waste of their time and just another survey where nothing happens. As a parent and a board member, I was saddened to learn that such a vast amount of our staff is so unhappy and disappointed with District 228, and that many would consider an opportunity to work somewhere else. The surveys were collected on February 19th and distributed to the full board for their review. It is my hope and expectation of this board to begin working together to find solutions to these problems and make our district a positive and productive environment for our staff and our students. After all, our most precious commodity, the students, are the ones who will suffer the most from the negative atmosphere.
I too have a statement on that topic I'd like to read for the record. As a parent, alumnus, taxpayer, and now board member, I am very concerned with the current findings of the recent staff survey that was collected on February 19th. After reviewing the surveys, it has been made very clear to me that a major disconnect exists between top administration and our frontline staff. There also appears to be very little trust when it comes to teachers believing what top administrators tell them. A great number of our staff stated that if given an opportunity to work in another district, they would. The same staff also reported that District 228 used to be a great place to work. With staff morale being as low as it is, it makes me question if this could be part of the reason why student achievement is as low as it is. I am a firm believer that leadership starts at the top. We, as the Board of Education, are at that top. I am encouraging each one of my fellow board members to work together to find solutions to pressing issues that are crippling our district and preventing our students and schools from reaching their full potential. I also ask all of you not to dismiss the voice of our teachers and support staff. These are the people that we hire to teach our students. They deserve our support. Thank you.
I'd just like to say, as one of the seven board members, I find it disconcerting that this whole process took place without the knowledge or consent of the majority of the board. I apologize to the teachers and staff members who received the survey, because I think if it represents a plus, it should have come from all of us. It should have been discussed before it was sent out. I question the power of the personnel committee to take such action without presentation to the full board. While I have looked at some of the surveys, I also question the power of two school board members to enter a building and reproduce thousands, I would estimate about 15,000 copies, without any authority that I'm aware of. I believe at this point it behooves the board to look at the results and see if something can be done. But since there was little, if any, restraints on the survey, one person could have duplicated and presented 50 answers. We have absolutely no idea what portion of our teaching staff this represents, and I find that unfortunate.
I have a couple things I would like to say and have good news, actually. I do value all the teachers and the staff, as well as the administration, and it is my duty to make sure that our students get the best quality education. And I know and value what teachers do daily, on a daily basis, and hope that we can find some positive resolution and peace for this, after these, I guess, surveys or whatever we have here have occurred. So I value the work that each one of you are doing. So besides that, I'll write a note. I would like I was able to attend the STEM workshop, STEM presentation given by the South Cook Division Winter Breakfast Meeting. I was able to attend that on February 27th. And the STEM presentation was three critical steps for developing a strong STEM program. And this presentation was given by our very own Dr. Corrine Williams, Assistant for Superintendent of Teaching and Learning, as well as Stephen Natt, the Science Department Supervisor. Is it Brandon? I'm sorry. Brandon. Over the last 4 years, Brim High School District 228 Science Department has gone through several major changes, and not only in its curriculum alignment to next generation science standards, but also its course sequencing, teacher methodology, integration of STEM opportunities, and articulation with its feeder schools. District 228 has responded to an ever-changing, complex world of giving students the necessary skills to make sense of everything altogether, comprehend the world around them, make informed decisions, and to innovate, lead, and create jobs for the future. Grimmon High School District 228 shared its planning and realities of transition to a fully incorporated STEM program implementation. This district has provided critical actions that are necessary to create a strong STEM program. For those that are not aware of STEM, it stands for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. And bringing all these together, it also symbolizes how to given real world examples. I believe there was a workshop that has been given to teachers district-wide as well as our feeder schools to help to create these programs. And I'm very excited about this program. I think it has been very effective, and I think it has a great future. It is where education is going, where this world is going as far as college career readiness. It also goes along with helping students to understand science, technology, and engineering and mathematics on a holistic scale. Also, I was able to attend student recognition night. Our students, there are several students that had achieved greatness, and I was able to, in several different areas, whether it be academics, attendance, or music, or other classes. I was able to attend that, shake their hands, and give rewards for it, and recognize some of the students that had achieved greatness in the district. And I just want to say kudos to those students, and keep up a good job. Got job for them. And to those who are over the different departments, thank you for all your hard work, dedication, and your personal time that you're giving that supersedes the regular hours. And I just thank you for that. And also, the South Cook Division will be meeting on the 14th. Is the next meeting for the South Cook Division governing meeting. That's all I have. Thank you.
I would like to say something about the teachers. I read those survey. In order for anything to work, everybody's going to have to come in and contribute. Let us, as a board, we only have one employee, and that's the superintendent. And we want to make sure that everybody gets heard, and it requires that if you put something down on paper, don't be afraid to say, okay, we can get together make some type of recommendations on how to solve each one of these problems. I don't think it's up to the board to try to figure out what the problem is. We just sat down here, maybe for myself, about 10 months ago or so. I will do whatever I can to help. If it means sitting out here, listening to both sides here, the administration, and they can look at those questions, and let's try to find a solution to them. But it's going to require some teachers maybe been at the district 5 years, and then maybe somebody at 10 years, or maybe 15 and above, so that we can get a great idea about what has changed from today, from 10, 15 years ago, that made the district great. That people will want to come back and work in. I'm an alumni from 1982. Let's try to see if we can work together. And then everybody has to participate, in my opinion. Please. Thank you.
Thank
some of the, I also want to thank the teachers that took the time to complete the surveys that were sent out. You can really tell that some teachers, some got into it. I think some of the things that board member Campworth and Canning failed to mention is that we did get some very positive feedback. Not all of them were bad, and I was really happy to read some of the stuff that was on there, especially as a parent also within the district. But at the end of the day, the volume of surveys that came back was not statistically sound. We did not get full participation, and we even came to our attention that we had teachers that filled out multiple surveys and a teacher that filled out 11 surveys. So that kind of waters down the findings from the result, from the survey results. It wasn't our intention to make that, so, that sort of opportunity. I think we were interested to see what teachers were thinking. But unfortunately, because of the way the results came back, there's just questions as to how valid they are now based on some of those, you know, things that we've heard. I think if you're not aware of reasons why to be proud of your district, you should probably definitely spend some time on the district website. There's a lot of material on there as far as the amount of growth. Maybe we're not where we want to be, but if you have to look at the growth of the students, really can't question the numbers, they're there. Same thing with finances, if there's concerns about finances, they're out there. You know, I get really discouraged when I hear students saying that their teachers are telling them that we're broke or that we're bankrupt. That really kind of tells me that they don't have all the information that's really there at their fingertips. So I think, you know, I do agree with Mark that there is a need for some collaboration, whether it be between the teachers and their departments or the departments and the administration. But I definitely want to make sure that everyone heard both sides of the coin.
There are some really good suggestions in some of those surveys. The major point that came across is people are very frustrated with the evaluation process, and as we said before, this is not something set in stone. It's an evolving tool. The thing that bothers me the most is that people are afraid to speak, to offer suggestions where they think a situation can be improved because somehow it's going to be held against them. We have teachers that aren't even collaborating with each other because they don't want somebody to steal their ideas and get a better rating on their evaluation. That just hurts the kids. The communication needs to be fixed. We can't address anything until people start talking. We are back where we were 15 years ago. Kids are different than they were 15 years ago. We used to get discipline reports, and it looked like we were a reform school with how many kids were being suspended. We can't educate a kid if he's not here. We're not helping that kid. Through this, I found out there's a student who was, a teacher who was having problems in his classroom first period. He found out that the kids were acting up and because they were starving. These kids didn't eat. So he got himself some styrofoam bowls, some Frosted Flakes. They had breakfast in the morning. And what a big change in the classroom environment and in the kids' grades. You know, we wish a lot of parents would take more responsibility, make sure their kids are doing the right thing. They don't, and unfortunately, a lot of the teachers have to take on those parenting roles. Kids are left to fend for themselves. I do think we'll have a lot of action from this. I am disappointed in a lot of the surveys. Highlighted negative issues, not necessarily looking to fix anything and not willing to take part of it. Over and over again, the comment was made, no one ever asked us, we're just the teachers, no one ever asked us, but then we're giving an opportunity to fix things and no suggestions are given. I do want to say though that from my point of view, there will be some changes made wherever we can. It's so sad, one person needs a handicapped parking spot. You don't feel comfortable to ask for a handicapped parking spot. There's no reason to be afraid to talk. And the way I look at it, if you talk to Dr. Kendall, that should protect you in some aspects because it's documented that you did go in.
if anything can be construed as retribution, we have it on paper. So I just want to send that message out. Do not be afraid to talk. Please don't stop talking to your fellow teachers. Share where you can to help the kids. And thanks for those who participated with the best intention in their heart. And to the teacher who filled out multiple, I'd like to have a conversation. I don't understand the purpose of that.
Was that an admitted that he or she filled out multiples?
Admitted by this person?
Yes.
No.
So we have no proof that multiples were put into the survey?
I do. Well,
we have proof?
I have other people saying it, yes.
And what school is that? You're not going to say what school that the survey talks with stuff? Why not? I don't understand. That doesn't incriminate anybody.
I really don't think we should discuss all this when the full board has never even discussed this whole process. From start to finish, what should have been done, how it was done, and what are we going to do when we get these results? That has not been a board discussion. I also think it's pretty hard to sit here in light of what we've watched tonight with the students, what we saw last week at student recognition, and say that everybody's so unhappy they just don't want to be here. Well, it looks like we got a bunch of kids who are doing great things, and that doesn't happen by accident.
I just want to also say at student recognition night, the kids always do a good job, the speakers. This year's students, their speeches were just phenomenal. And very much beyond their years. They were just so good. And also, I know at Spirit Night, it says that Tinley Park High School was the overall winner, but the boys at Hillcrest, who did the cheer, they could compete against that girls' team. That's all I have. Mr. O'Malley, if you want to start us off with finance. Or, I'm sorry, Mr. Russell.
I'll do. Finance Committee met on Tuesday, March 8th. Meeting was called to order at 8:01 p.m. Present were myself, Mr. Canning, Mrs. Campworth, and Mr. O'Malley. Our guests were Mrs. Gleason and Mr. Dale Thompson. For new business, we had March bills, impress funds, and deposits. The committee reviewed and discussed the March bills, impress expenditures, and deposits. These items have been reviewed with the superintendent, who, along with the finance committee, is recommending full board approval of the March bills, addendums to bills, impress expenditures, and deposits. Over $5,000 purchase orders, there were none. Career Development System, CDS bills. The committee reviewed the CDS March bills totaling $16,936.02. The finance committee has reviewed these items and, along with the superintendent, is recommending full board approval of the CDS March bills as presented. Paper bids. The bids for the district's paper was sent to six vendors, with five vendors returning bids. These bids were discussed and reviewed. The lower bidder was Midland Paper. This vendor has provided quality service and product to the district in the past. The finance committee, along with the superintendent, is recommending full board approval of the low bid of $24,136 submitted by Midland Paper. Discussion. The finance committee briefly discussed the QSCB bond issue, timelines for the issue, and potential options pertaining to the federal reimbursements from the QSCB program. The next meeting is April 11th, 2016 at 7 p.m. in the Administration Center, and the meeting was adjourned at 8:26 p.m.
Ms. Campworth?
Teaching and Learning Committee met on March 8th. The meeting was called to order at 6:30. Present at the meeting were myself, Mrs. Gleason, and Dr. Williams. Absent was Ms. Stearns. Guests were Mr. Canning and Mr. Dale Thompson.
I'd just like to add that I was there.
Oh, I'm sorry. Family emergency. Well, it says for the absence. So. There were no comments from the public. The Danielson student growth discussion over the course of three meetings. The committee was provided with information related to the development and implementation of the Danielson framework and the student growth model for teacher evaluation. The committee had an opportunity to ask follow-up questions and discuss concerns related to this process. Mr. Canning raised some concerns with regard to the evaluation process. The committee would like to revisit this topic next month and has asked Dr. Williams to gather information related to teacher training and tools used by other districts. Ms. Stearns inquired in the previous meeting about how class rank is determined for the top 10 students for graduation purposes. The top 10 is determined after 7 semesters of work, as GPA is based on semester, not quarter grades. This ranking is used to honor students at the district recognition night in March and senior honors nights at each of the high schools. Furthermore, since there are only 2 school days in between the seniors' last day of attendance and graduation, there is not enough time to print graduation programs, write, review, and practice graduation speeches in the event that the rankings change. Textbook adoption. Dr. Williams presented new textbooks and supplemental materials, such as workbooks, to the committee for review. These materials will support the curricular changes made in French 2, Honors French 2, World History, AP American History, and BPA. In addition, new high-interest novels are being adopted to support the curriculum being taught in English Skills Extended, Introduction to English, Studies in Contemporary Literature, and Speculative Literature. All of these resources will be on display in the Administrative Center for the next 30 days and will be presented to the full board for approval in April. The committee reviewed budgets for its annual summer academy programs at all 4 high schools. These programs include an extended school year for our students in Excel, Summer Academy, and AP pre-AP camps. These programs will be brought to the full board for approval. To address concerns related to the inefficiency of our evaluation process, the district has been reviewing software companies that specialize in evaluation software. The use of a software for teacher, support staff, and coaching evaluations will help reduce the amount of paper and will make the process more efficient for its users. A team of administrators, along with the district evaluation committee, has reviewed potential products and has narrowed the list down to 2 providers, EvaluWise and TalentEd. The teams will be making their final decision this month, and a recommendation will be made to the Teaching and Learning Committee in April. Mrs. Camworth asked about a survey being conducted by the P20 Council regarding dual credit. The mission of the P20 Council is to create a seamless system of quality education and support in order to maximize students' educational attainment, opportunities for success in the workforce, and contributions to their local communities. The purpose of the survey is to assess the district's current state of dual credit. The survey link will be shared with the board. Lastly, Mrs. Camworth inquired about changes in the law related to special education. I was referenced to the Director of Special Education for further information. Next meeting will be held on Tuesday, April 12th at 6:30 at the Ed Center, and the meeting adjourned at 7:55 p.m.
Thank you. Mr. O'Malley.
Thank you, Ms. Stearns. Board members, item 10.1 pertains to our monthly bills, the addendum to the bills, payroll, and CDS bills. Along with the Finance Committee, the Superintendent is recommending those to the board this evening.
So moved.
Second. Moved by Ms. Ressler, second by Mrs. Gleason. Any discussion? Discussion.
Mrs. Ressler?
Aye.
Mrs. Gleason?
Aye.
Mr. Canning?
Aye.
Mr. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. Jones?
Aye.
Mrs. Camworth?
Aye.
Ms. Stearns?
Aye.
Item 10.2 pertains to our spring paper bid. As Ms. Ressler had mentioned, Midland Paper was the low bidder. That is the bidder that the Finance Committee and the Superintendent are recommending to the board.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Ms. Ressler, second by Mr. Canning. Any discussion?
Tom, what quality paper are we buying?
It's the same bond quality that we buy each year. We'll test it to make sure that we don't have any issues.
Copiers,
yeah, it was more of an issue with the scanners from Master Manager than copiers, but we'll make sure that when the game comes in, we test it out.
I think it was
doesn't cause problems.
Bramit that said that the copy repair guy had said the paper was causing the machine to jam.
Yeah, there's been different matters of opinion on
but we did replace all the machines recently, too, right?
Yes. Well, they're going on 2 years old, though.
How long do they usually live?
Usually there's a 5-year cycle on them.
There was a time when we had paper still on top.
us, it was a different bond of paper that was being used. It might have been some of our older ad stock that we had that was not working. So we eliminated that from using that with the copier. So that is a problem.
As I said, Mrs. Campworth and myself, we ran the copies for the service off, and the paper was fantastic. So.
Ms. Ressler?
Aye.
Mr. Canning?
Aye.
Ms. Gleason?
Aye.
Mr. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. Jones?
Aye.
Mrs. Campworth?
Aye.
Ms. Stern?
Aye.
Sorry, Dr.
Williams. That's okay. Item 10.3 are the Summer Academy AP Camp and Pre-AP Camp budgets. Board members, you have a copy of the dollar figures for each of the buildings. The total cost to run our summer programs is just over $47,000. This is up about $1,700 from last year, and that's due to the increase in the pay rate for the teachers. We're also projected to be down 50 students in enrollment. So that's the difference in the figures. Teaching and Learning Committee, along with the superintendent, are recommending the Summer Academy proposals for full board approval.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Ms. Gleason, second by Mr. Johnson. Any discussion?
I have a question, Ms. Ernst, to Mrs. Williams. We're down 50 students for our Summer Academy, and we did go over it committee. Where is the greatest number?
It's a smattering in each of the schools.
Is it?
Yes.
There's no one school that has a certain amount more than...
No, so, the one concern we had last year where Hillcrest was down was because we ran the AP camp and summer geometry at the same time.
Okay.
So students had to pick.
Okay.
So this year the AP camp is in the evening.
Okay.
So those students can go
home. Can that number in fact increase between now and the time?
Oh, absolutely. And the assistant principal yes. Still recruits. I mean, we usually get students the first day. So these are just projected figures right now.
And, you know, as I stated in committee meeting, I really, really think that this is a great program, the Summer Academy.
Ms. Gleason?
Aye.
Mr. Johnson?
Aye.
Mr. Canning?
Aye.
Mrs. Jones?
Aye.
Mrs. Campbell?
Aye.
Mrs. Ressler?
Aye.
Ms. Stearns?
Aye.
Item 10.4 is the annual IHSA membership for the 2016 and 2017 school year. It should be noted that there's no charge for this membership, and I'm recommending this for full board for approval.
Second.
Moved by Ms. Gleason, second by Ms. Ressler. Any discussion?
How did it become free, Dr. Kendall? Well, we paid for this years past, right? Or was that conference? Maybe I'm thinking conference.
Yeah, correct. Okay.
All right, Mrs. Gleason?
Aye.
Mrs. Ressler?
Aye.
Mr. Canning?
Aye.
Mr. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. Jones?
Aye.
Mrs. Campworth?
Aye.
Ms. Stearns?
Dr. Craggins?
10.5 pertains to the 2016-2017 staffing for District 228.
Time to
motion
open the floor.
So moved.
Second. Moved by Mrs. Gleason, second by Mrs. Jones.
Floor is open.
Can I get you?
Not yet. Item 10.5.3 is a staffing resolution for 2016-2017. This time, I suggest Ms. Campworth to read the resolution, please.
Resolution authorizing reemployment of certified staff for the 2016-2017 school term, plus dismissal notices, resignations, and retirements. Whereas this Board of Education has received recommendations from members of the administration concerning the number of teachers and educational support personnel needed to be employed in the school district for the 2016-2017 school term. and whereas this Board of Education has received recommendations from members of the administration concerning the subject area needs and corresponding teaching positions of this district for the 2016-2017 school term. Now therefore be it resolved by the Board of Education, Bremen Community High School District Number 228, Cook County, Illinois, as follows. That the staff listed in Section 1 on contractual continued service shall be reemployed for the 2016-2017 school term. That the staff listed in Section 2, first-year probationary teachers, shall be reemployed for the 2016-2017 school term and placed on second-year probationary status. That the staff listed in Section 3, second-year probationary teachers, be reemployed for the 2016-2017 school term and placed on the third-year probationary status. That the staff listed in Section 4, third-year probationary teachers, be reemployed for the 2016-2017 school term and placed on fourth-year probationary status. That the staff listed in Section 5, fourth-year probationary teachers, be reemployed and placed on tenure for the 2016-2017 school term. Section 6, that tenure teachers as listed be honorably dismissed effective at the end of the 2015-2016 school term for the following reasons: A, declining enrollment; B, teachers returning from leaves; and C, fluctuations in subject areas. We have none. Section 7, that the following fourth-year probationary teachers hereby be dismissed at the end of the 2015-2016 school term due to a decision of this Board of Education to discontinue particular types of teaching services or for reasons included in notices approved by the Board of Education. There are none. Section 8, that the following third-year probationary teacher staff hereby be dismissed at the end of the 2015-2016 school term. There are none. Section 9, that the following second-year probationary teachers hereby be dismissed at the end of the 2015-2016 school term. There are none. Section 10, that the following first-year probationary teachers are dismissed at the end of the 2015-2016 school term: Colleen Curran, Nicole D'Onofrio. Section 11, that the following part-time and long-term substitute teachers are dismissed at the end of the 2015-2016 school term or the effective date as outlined in their individual employment agreements: Dana Benda, Lauren Brazell, Michael DeLuca, Edgar Gonzalez Beza, Cynthia Goodwin, Michael Jevons, John Jensen, Caitlin Kelly, Jeremy Lannon Sr., Suzanne Lappy, Thomas Piotrowski, Hanan Shahiber, and I'm sorry if I mispronounced any of the names. Section 12, that the following resignations, retirements, leaves be accepted on the effective dates as listed: Kathleen Andrews, Joseph Banich, Anna Marie Derensburg, Safka Meldanovich, Beth Ringwald, Lori Shemosky, Taras Skurlock, Will Linda Spates, Jerry Ward. Section 13, that the President of the Board of Education is directed to sign all required letters of dismissal notice and cause the school district administration to send such notices to each person requiring the same by certified mail and personal delivery. Section 14, that this resolution shall be in full force and effective upon its adoption.
Do we have a second on the resolution?
Second.
By Ms. Campbell, second by Ms. Gleason. Any discussion?
No discussion.
Mrs. Campbell, aye. Mrs. Gleason,
aye.
Mr. Canning?
Aye.
Mr. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. Jones?
Aye.
Mrs. Ressler?
Aye.
Ms. Stearns?
Aye.
The notices of dismissal is also covered.
Right, so we don't need the sun. No.
Item 10.6, personnel under resignation: Raymond Hayes, Yvette Hayes, Nora Dunn, and Tora Skurlock. Under leave: Lori Gennardo. Under retirements: Amy Exo, Sam Liros, Jennifer Liros. Under employment: Shatina Hoskin, Jordan Walker, Luther Boyd, and Justin Bojan. Under change in position: Paige Strizek and Jane Dempsey. Board's Personnel Committee did not meet on March 7th. However, Dr. Kendall has reviewed the many certificated and support staff items, and these are now being recommended to the full board.
So moved.
Second.
By Ms. Stern, second by Mr. Johnson. Any discussion?
The positions have changed.
Paige Isaac is a physical education teacher, will become the guidance counselor, and Jane Dempsey is the assistant principal for student services, will be the assistant principal for teaching and learning.
Was this the year that we were going to have like 20 teachers retired?
Next year.
Okay, thank you. Sorry.
Ms. Stearns?
Yeah, aye.
Mr. Johnson?
Aye.
Mr. Canning?
I'm going to abstain.
Mrs. Gleason?
Aye.
Mrs. Jones?
Abstain.
Mrs. Camworth, aye. Mr. Wrestler?
Aye.
Mrs. Wrestler, I'm sorry.
Aye.
Motion passes. Looking for a motion to move to closed session to consider information regarding the appointment, employment, compensation, discipline, performance, or dismissal of specific employees and student discipline.
Second.
By Ms. Wrestler, second by Mr. Johnson.
Mrs. Wrestler?
Aye.
Mr. Johnson?
Aye.
Mr. Canning?
Aye.
Mrs. Gleason?
Aye.
Mrs. Jones?
Aye.
Mrs. Camworth?
Aye.
Ms. Stearns?
Aye.
So moved.
I'm sorry.
Second.
So moved.
Moved by Mrs. Jones, second by Mr. Giles. Yeah.
Mrs. Jones?
Aye.
Mr. Johnson?
Aye.
Mr. Canning?
Aye.
Mrs. Gleason?
Aye.
Mrs. Camworth, aye. Mrs. Wrestler, aye. Ms. Stearns?
Aye. Evelyn, you want to read your motion?
I move to suspend employee 2016A without pay until May 3rd, 2016.
Second. No discussion?
Mrs. Gleason?
Aye.
Mr. Canning?
Aye.
Mr. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. Jones?
Aye.
Mrs. Camworth?
Aye.
Mrs. Wrestler?
Aye.
Ms. Stearns?
Aye. Mrs. Camworth, would you read your motion?
I move to administratively transfer student 315161 to alternative school for at least the remainder of the 2015-2016 school year as discussed in closed session on March 15, 2016.
So moved.
Moved by Ms. Camworth, second by Mr. Canning. Discussion?
Mrs. Camworth, aye. Mr. Canning?
Aye.
Mrs. Gleason?
Aye.
Mr. Johnson?
Aye.
Mrs. Jones?
Aye.
Mrs. Wrestler?
Aye.
Ms. Stearns?
Aye. Our announcements are as follows. Committee of the Whole on Tuesday, April 5th, 7 p.m. at Oak Forest. Personnel, Monday, April 11th, 6:30 at the Ann Center. Finance, 7 p.m. at the Ann Center. Teaching and Learning, Tuesday, April 12th, 7 p.m. at the Ed Center. The next board meeting will be April 19th, 7 p.m. at Oak Forest High School. Can I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Mrs. Jones, second by Mr. Johnson. All in favor, aye.
Aye.